A very good morning to all of you. Thank you very much for joining us for this important session on Europe this morning. I'm very grateful for the Amadeus Institute for having put Europe again this year on the agenda. The European Union seems to be moving from one emergency to the next. I mean, first came the sovereign or the global recession back in 2008, then came the European debt crisis, and today it's on the diplomatic and the security front that the EU is dealing with tremendous challenges. We have the conflicts in the Ukraine, in Syria, in Libya on the one hand, over a million refugees sought asylum in Europe last year, terrorism struck at its heart in France, in Germany, in Belgium. And last June, Britain decided to leave the European Union, abandoning an integration process that was so far seen as irreversible. There is an old saying that says that Europe is forged in times of crisis. And if that saying is only half true, then there are still plenty of reasons to be optimistic. So it's going to be a fascinating discussion. There are a lot of topics to talk about. And without further ado, let me introduce those speakers that kindly accepted to join this morning's discussion. Jan Karnogórski is a retired Slovak politician. Among others, he held the positions of Minister for Justice and also served as Prime Minister of Slovakia. Mark Ellenbogen is the chairman of the Global Panel Foundation, a respected NGO which works behind the scenes in crisis around the world. Mariam Rakiashvili is a member of the Georgian Parliament. She currently serves as State Minister of Georgia on European and Euro-Atlantic integration. George Papandreou is a Greek politician. He was the leader of the PASOK party for 8 years. He's held various cabinet positions, including Minister of Foreign Affairs from 1999 to 2004, and Prime Minister between 2009 and 2011. Volodymyr Kandogi, apologize if I mispronounce, is a career diplomat joining us from the Ukraine. He represented Ukraine at the UNESCO, served as ambassador to Belgium, to Luxembourg, and to the Netherlands, but also to NATO. He also served as Minister of Foreign Affairs to the Ukraine back in 2009. Last but not least, Juha Korkeaoja is a Finnish politician, member of the parliament since 1991, and currently chairman of the Defense and Security Commission of the Finnish Parliament. Also, last but not least, Paulo Portas is joining us from Portugal. He's a Portuguese politician and also served as Vice Prime Minister and Minister of Foreign Affairs of Portugal. To get the discussion starting, I think it's fair to say that everyone was astounded upon learning of the outcomes of Britain's referendum on the European Union. George, I'd like to start with you. Is the Brexit a turning point in EU integration?
Press this here, okay. Well, the importance of Europe is that it's not just a geographical formation, it is has been seen, and it should be seen as an experiment, a project about how we in this globalizing world can work together. And even though it began as a peace project, it now is one which is having to deal with more global trends, whether it's the financial crisis, whether it's the refugee crisis, whether it is climate change. And we have to adapt, and our institutions have to adapt to being more effective. I would say that this is not the failure of Europe, but it's the failure of Europe to use its capacity to deal with these issues. we have not been able to deal with these issues in the most effective way. We've been muddling through the financial crisis, the sovereign debt crisis when I was prime minister. We didn't take the strongest decisions. We haven't had a real comprehensive refugee policy, asylum policy. And of course, in our competitiveness with around the world, with the austerity measures and so on, this has alienated made people in Europe, a large part of Europe, feel marginalized. And that has been captured by certain politicians or certain political movements, populist, nativist, and therefore, I think that's part of what Brexit we see. I think Brexit could be a wake-up call. I think it is, of course, from my point of view, it's not the solution. I often, going through crises, I would say, why don't I go to a Greek island and just isolate myself, drink my wine, my feta, Greek salads, fish, and so on. But then you realize that even a nice, beautiful Greek island is not isolated from the world problems when a refugee will be there or climate change will hit. And I think that this isolationism that was we see this reaction to globalization, which has its roots and it has its problems, the solution to these problems at global level are not isolationism, are not type of Brexit and so on. Can we in Europe overcome this is the big question. And I think we need a new narrative around Europe. We need to strengthen Europe. I am favor of more integration, but also more of a democratic Europe, so people feel more empowered. So hopefully it's a wake-up call for Europe to really rethink how it can be more effective and, I would say, more democratic and build on its strengths.
You say it's a wake-up call for Europe. And I think it's fair to say that so far the EU integration had been seen as a fairly irreversible process. And now other European governments could come under pressure to offer their voters a vote on EU membership. Paulo, is this something that you see and you hear in Portugal? And do you think this is a trend, or how can we stop this trend?
Bon, je vais parler en français. Et heureusement, le Portugal n'a pas la tentation des extrémismes. On l'a jamais eu, heureusement. Mais si vous me permettez, si vous regardez l'Europe, soit de quel point que vous choisissez, il n'y a que des problèmes. Vous avez un problème sérieux avec la Russie, pas résolu stratégiquement. Vous avez un problème inédit, ça veut dire un grand pays qui s'en va de l'Europe. On a été élevé dans l'idée qu'on pourrait rentrer mais pas sortir. Vous avez un problème qui a collapsé le procédure de décision européen. Il s'appelle migration. Avec 1 million de migrants, l'Europe a collapsé. Imaginez combien de réfugiés vous avez en Jordanie ou en Turquie. Vous avez un problème de nouvelles formes de terrorisme avec recrutement antérieur dans l'Europe. Vous avez une immense perte de compétitivité de l'Europe. Et je veux ajouter quelques points sur ce point-là. Économiquement, l'Europe est en déclin depuis 20 ans, depuis la globalisation et surtout la digitalisation de l'économie, l'Europe est en perte de vitesse. Et vous avez une crise financière qui est pas résolue. C'est pas normal que 8 ans après la crise Lehman Brothers, vous avez encore en Italie une grande économie de l'euro, un problème systémique dans le système financier. 300 000 milliards d'euros dans la troisième économie de l'euro. Bon. Donc, si vous ajoutez ça, et en très grand point d'interrogation dans la frontière avec l'Asie, qui s'appelle Turquie, on collectionne des problèmes dans le moment où vous avez moins leadership. Vous êtes au Maroc. Le royaume du Maroc a un fantastique roi. Vous n'avez pas ni de fantastique roi, ni de fantastique président en Europe à ce moment-là. Vous avez une absence de leadership. Si j'ajoute, je veux seulement ajouter 3 ou 4 chiffres, si vous me permettez, qui sont d'ailleurs très impressifs sur cette crise européenne. Regardez la liste des 10 plus grandes entreprises du monde. La plus récente, aucune est européenne. 5 américaines, 5 chinoises. La première européenne, c'est la 12e. Regardez pour le nouveau business, pour l'espoir dans l'économie créative, disponibilité de venture capital. En Europe, 0,03 du PIB. En Amérique, 0,3 du PIB. Ça fait toute la différence. Donc, des nouvelles générations avec des bonnes idées de business ont de l'accès au financement. En Europe, bloqué. Troisième seulement chiffre que je voudrais vous... On a eu une crise de 1 million de réfugiés. On ne parle jamais des 800 000 qui peut-être sont allés en Allemagne. Mais l'Union européenne a accepté de relocaliser, si vous voulez, 160 000 réfugiés. Vous savez à ce jour-là combien sont relocalisés ? 8 000. 5%. C'est incroyable, c'est honteux du point de vue européen. Et finalement, seulement pour vous donner en matière de compétitivité, de flexibilité, un Américain change de ville et d'emploi au moins 11 fois pendant la vie. Vous savez combien de fois un Européen change d'emploi pendant la vie ? 3 à 4, dans la meilleure hypothèse. Donc, on est en perte de compétitivité. Et qu'est-ce que vous voyez, et je termine, aujourd'hui dans l'Europe ? On n'a pas d'enfants. On est contre les immigrants. On est pour les droits acquis. On ne sait jamais avec qui on va payer les droits acquis pour tout le monde tout le temps. Et maintenant, on devient contre le commerce ouvert. Ça, c'est une stratégie pour le désastre. C'est pourquoi la croissance européenne, c'est la moitié de l'américaine, et le chômage européen, c'est le double de l'américain.
Et la conséquence ?
Et donc, la conséquence, c'est une... Vous êtes... J'ai jamais pensé... J'ai pas vécu, heureusement, le 20e siècle tragique de l'Europe. Je sais, et je suis héritier de cette mémoire, que l'Europe sans Union européenne, c'est la guerre. C'est l'histoire de l'Europe. L'Union européenne, c'est le plus exiteux du point de vue historique. Période de paix et de prospérité dans un continent traversé par des conflits et des guerres.
Et pourtant, on ne peut pas nier qu'y compris au Portugal...
Comment ?
Y compris au Portugal, récemment...
Non, le Portugal était assez stable dans cette matière.
Bon. C'est un gouvernement en partie eurosceptique qui est arrivé au pouvoir et la tendance oui. se renforce aussi dans d'autres
Mais
pays.
Mais je dirais que les pays... Le problème, vous savez, pendant la crise financière, on avait l'habitude de parler des pays du Sud comme s'ils étaient égaux les uns les autres. Le problème aujourd'hui en Europe... C'est bien différent. Je vous laisse une question provocatrice. Est-ce que c'est la meilleure décision de regarder la Russie avec les yeux qu'on utilisait pour regarder l'Union soviétique ? La moitié de la classe politique européenne regarde Moscou comme elle regardait quand il existait l'Union soviétique. Et ça a des conséquences stratégiques. Si on n'a pas un agrément avec la Russie, il y a des problèmes qui s'aggravent. 90% de la classe politique américaine regarde la Russie comme elle regardait l'Union soviétique. Écoutez, ce que vous avez à Moscou pose des problèmes, mais ce n'est pas l'Union soviétique, c'est la Russie. C'est millénaire, éternel, autocratique, un peu impérial si elle a les moyens, mais c'est une continuité historique, c'est plus un projet totalitaire global. C'est pas plus le pacte de Varsovie. Et écoutez, je vous demande seulement ça. Si M. Trump arrive en agrément avec M. Poutine, quelle sera la position des Européens après avoir accepté faire en Libye ce qu'ils ont fait et faire en Ukraine ce qu'ils ont fait? Imaginez un accord Poutine-Trump. Quelle sera la position de l'Europe? Donc il faut poser la question stratégique de la Russie. Si on veut, par exemple, stabiliser la Syrie. Si on veut éviter des champs d'entraînement de terroristes de nouvelle génération. Il faut poser le problème stratégique avec la Russie, par exemple. Et vous ne voyez pas, et je termine, il n'y a pas de débat politique substantiel aujourd'hui en Europe. Et donc, des questions que je considère très relevantes politiquement ou économiquement, elles sont plus ou moins absentes. Il reste le leadership de Mme Merkel. C'est le seul stable. Elle va au quatrième mandat, mais je ne vois ailleurs... d'autres possibilités.
We're going to talk about the leadership and the relationship to Russia in a moment, and it's a very, very important question. But first I wanted to just finish to tackle the question of how the populations, the European populations, relate to the Union. George mentioned before a lack of democracy. Juha, you join us from Finland. Is it your feeling there as well that the EU has lost the support of the populations?
Thank you. I think that the populist movements in just about every European country shows that it has happened something between the elite, political elite, and the people of European countries. So it is a clear sign that the democracy is not functioning properly. But after Brexit, the big question is what is the future of European Union? Well, by the way, I have to say that we should separate the what is the future of European Union and another question, what is the future of Eurozone, monetary union. So, but if we think European Union and its future, we have seen many years two ways of thinking different European countries. Those who want deeper and deeper integration, and those who want enlargement, but mainly free trade, etc. European Union concentrating in the market questions, not going into the direction of a federal state. So that will be perhaps the biggest question now after Brexit. What will be the direction of European Union after Brexit? My personal perspective is that European countries are not prepared for a federal state, so we should continue as a union of independent states and concentrate in the trade questions, creating trade questions and concentrating to be competitive vis-à-vis USA and China, etc. So those are the tasks I would say the people of European Union want European Union to do?
I mean, to me, this change of hearts when it comes to the EU is particularly spectacular in East European countries, which more and more, I feel, turn against a EU, a European Union that they fought so hard to join. We see this in Poland, we see this in Hungary. More and more countries express the desire to cherry pick, it is what you say, what they want in an overly, or what they perceive as being an overly bureaucratic union. They want the benefits, but they don't want the costs. Jan, are we moving towards a Europe à la carte, so to say, where everyone would be cherry-picking what he wants?
First, I would like to say that in all these countries you have mentioned, the support of membership of each country in EU is higher than negative voices. First. Second, of course, in economic terms, there are practically not very big differences or very big negative voices against EU. In another field, for example, maybe in economic policy or in when European Union tries to intrude into questions of education, maybe sometime culture, there are strong negative voices, but in general, in these countries are Euro-optimistic still. Of course, because these countries are new ones in EU, the critics and not support of certain aspects of EU politics is stronger than in so-called old countries. For example, in Visegrad group of countries was strong negative voices against so-called quotas politics of Brussels, of EU, that according to this politics should be the migrants to Europe divided into various countries. Half of billion in people, inhabitants, EU must be able to manage, say, 1 million of migrants, 2 millions, even 3 millions of migrants. But the coming of next mass migration should be stopped somehow. And this in these countries, we have had opinion that European Union, Brussels, is not doing a proper politics to stop or just to radically slow down the coming of next migrants to EU, and that's why this negative voices against this dimension of EU politics. And we have won.
Yeah, I think what you say as well, or what the issue also you point to, is solidarity, right?
Solidarity, of course, solidarity, mm-hmm. But solidarity that should lead to a constructive politics, because I repeat, if the mass of migrants to European Union would go on 4 years, 4 years in millions, then even so-called old countries of EU would not be able to accommodate these migrants. And that's why some another type of politics should be applied. And now, not only in these so-called new countries, but even in Germany, in Austria, there are voices that EU should apply some another type of politics. In Austria, the candidate for presidency, he lost, but not very, very strong. He proposed a politics of creating areas in Africa, in Libya, maybe Iraq, maybe Syria, creating of areas where these migrants could be with support, with financing of EU, be accommodated. So it's a sign that politics of EU, for example, in this area of migration, was not proper and something has to be done. And practically is slowly, but is being done.
George, we talked about solidarity. We talked about Europe sort of à la carte. You served as prime minister at the peak of the sovereign debt crisis, which touched Greece, but also touched Ireland, Portugal, Cyprus, to some extent Spain. When you think back about how the situation was managed by the EU institutions and by what was called the Troika, what does it say about solidarity in Europe today?
Well, I would say that Europe has a great capacity which it is not using. We at that time with the financial crisis, of course Greece had its problems, and I inherited a very difficult situation with bad statistics and a huge debt, and I had to deal with it. But I was facing, and Europe were facing, the fears of the global markets, the debt markets, the sovereign debt, the sovereign markets, funds, and so on. Had Europe at that time been able to say, okay, Greece is going to do its program, which I was doing and adjusting, we had to adjust, but we are here to guarantee the Eurozone, the Euro, the program in Greece, don't worry, which at a later stage Draghi actually did in 2012. Had they done that had we done that at the very beginning, we could have avoided much pain and really been much more effective. So what, and this, the proof of it is that when Draghi did actually say, we will do whatever it takes to calm the markets, it actually worked for a period of time anyway. We still are muddling through. But it shows that if we are together and work, we can solve these issues. So for me, whether it's the financial crisis, whether it is the refugee problem, it is appalling. I agree with Mr. Portas that it's appalling that we cannot deal with this problem when Jordan or Lebanon have many more millions than we have. We can deal with the refugee crisis. We can integrate refugees. I don't think it's the bureaucracy that's the problem.
But some in the union do not want to bear the cost.
And I believe that there are some underlying problems. If we had a growth policy, which we could have had in Europe. Yesterday we were talking about the link of energy grids to Northern Africa, Morocco, and other parts of Northern Africa to Europe. We could have invested in our neighborhood. In a win-win situation, we could have invested in green grids much more effectively in Europe, in energy grids. That's geopolitically important too. We could have invested in more transportation. We could have had a growth policy, which China had, which the U.S. had initially after the crisis in 2008 with TARP, which even Trump today is talking about. So we could have had and money is cheap right now. This was a wrong policy as Europe. Not talking about country to country. We as Europeans could have invested much more and made Europe more competitive. We could have had the single market, the infrastructure, and so on. We could have had a greening of Europe. We could have dealt with the refugee crisis. I think also had we done that, the refugee issue would be much more difficult, because what people feel now is this social contract, which is very much part of Europe. Don't forget that Europe is very much this idea of social cohesion. In our competition with other parts of the world, with the emerging markets, there's often this feeling of we are a race to the bottom and people are being marginalized, they're losing their security. Then what comes in are the issues of identity, of fear of the other, of refugees, of this scaremongering, the scapegoating. So I don't think the refugee problem per se, it is a problem, but it is not the issue. The underlying issues is, can Europe get its act together, really hold on to its values, which are an open society, which are a social cohesion, and therefore deal with issues such as the refugee crisis, And there are underlying issues for the refugee crisis too. We were absent. We are basically absent in the Mediterranean. Unluckily, even though we have policies, neighborhood issues, we're talking about Ukraine and so on. We could also be much more of a player in these areas. And I think this shows also that the decision-making process in Europe, we're intermingled, we're very interdependent, but we are not flexible in making decisions. And we have left decisions to the bureaucracy or to the stronger in Europe, like is Germany and so on. I have always said, why don't we elect our president in Europe? Why not? Let's have somebody who can, man or woman, who can represent and have the this legitimacy, this democratic legitimacy to move Europe forward. So there are things we can do. But the problem is that now, there are lots of movements that feel that the easy way to deal with this is more isolation or bashing Europe or this populism or fear of the other, politics of fear. We need the leadership to break that down, to think of a different Europe, a different narrative.
Paolo, one word on this?
Just to mention two or three things about the first of all, just give you, je vous donne trois chiffres sur la démographie. Qu'est-ce que vous avez? Quel est le minimum vital pour replacer génération dans une société? Deux fils pour femme. 2,01 plus précisément. Quel est le taux démographique de fécondité de l'Europe? 1,6. Dans la meilleure hypothèse, Espagne et Portugal, par exemple, 1,3. Quel est le taux de fécondité de l'Afrique? 4,6. On parle des fondamentaux. Ça veut dire que l'Europe n'est pas en condition de générer jeunesse suffisante pour soutenir et payer et financer les systèmes sociaux. Il faut le dire ouvertement. Donc, si on n'a pas la démographie, on doit avoir une politique au moins modérément ouverte vers l'immigration. Quand la chancelière Merkel a dit cette phrase qui a sauvé l'honneur de l'Europe, mais qui était non opérationnelle, je ne vais pas repatrier aucun réfugié de Syrie. Évidemment, il n'y a pas de technologie pour distinguer qu'est-ce qu'un réfugié, qu'est-ce qu'un demandeur d'asile, qu'est-ce qu'un migrant économique, ou quelle est la petite cellule dangereuse de yihadisme qui va dans la marche des migrations. Bon, donc il n'y a pas de technologie suffisante, il n'y a pas de coopération de sécurité suffisante, il n'y a pas de coopération suffisante en matière d'intelligence en Europe pour faire la distinction. Mais en tout cas, je reviens à un point, c'est 1 million de réfugiés. La Jordanie en a des millions, la Turquie en a 3 millions. Ça a collapsé le continent européen à cause des populismes. Et je dois le dire, je crois que les démocrates, avec peu d'exceptions, ont fait une de deux choses, ou le silence, où ils veulent imiter l'extrême gauche ou l'extrême droite, et donc ils vont la légitimer. Ce n'est pas possible de garder la compétitivité d'Europe sans une portion raisonnable d'immigration. Ça, je veux le dire très clairement. La deuxième mention que je voudrais faire, c'est que, et sans investir et co-développer nommément l'Afrique. Le deuxième mention que je voudrais dire un peu d'une façon ironique, il n'est pas nécessaire d'être un démocrate pour gagner des élections ailleurs. C'est ce qui se passe avec M. Poutine. Il gagne des élections aux des sympathies les unes après les autres. Et je mentionne seulement ça. Vous avez chaque jour plus dans l'Est de l'Europe une définition stratégique vers Moscou et pas vers Bruxelles. C'est le retour à la nature historique des nations. Vous avez, dans les derniers mois, Vous le savez, bon, M. Trump a été élu aux États-Unis avec une certaine russophilie. François Fillon est russophile, si vous le comparez avec les autres. Le président de Bulgarie, russophile, etc. Vous avez déjà l'Hongrie. Ce que j'appelle, I just called the attention. Les nations reviennent à sa nature. Et la définition stratégique vers Moscou devient plus importante parfois que la définition vers la faiblesse de Bruxelles. Bon.
We'll talk about these, and I think this makes a lovely transition to the key external policy challenges that the that the EU is facing now. We talked about Russia, and we're going to talk about this in a minute. We talked about the migrants and how this is shaping Europe today and governments today. Actually, the one question I want to start with is the US election. Mark, we've seen the election of an isolationist president in the White House. What does this new presidency mean for Europe, and in particular for its external and for its neighborhood policy?
Sorry. Well, if Europe is going back to its roots, I would say the United States is doing the same thing. I mean, it isn't just that Trump is an isolationist, but he's a proactive person. And so, look, the U.S. was dragged into World War I. It was dragged into World War II. If you think of Teddy Roosevelt, he said, walk quietly and carry a big stick, but he meant it vis-a-vis South and Central America. The fact is the U.S. has never been a comfortable superpower. We're not equipped with languages, although we have tons of immigrants. We're not equipped with a lot of things that would make us able to do these things. And so I think, in fact, if you're saying Europe is going back to its roots, the U.S. is doing the same thing. Why? Well, it's tired. There's malaise after wars in Iraq, wars in, from Yugoslavia to Rwanda to Somalia to many different places, Libya, the list just goes on and on and on. And people are tired of having their sons and daughters. I mean, I'm sorry, I come from a security background, as many of you know from having heard me before. And so the U.S. is entrenching itself, and it's entrenching itself for many of the reasons the European Union fiddles and faddles about making decisions, though the U.S. does make decisions, much less so under President Trump. And I think that's the big common denominator, that there's a lack of proaction. How is Trump going to affect these things? Well, I think he's going to be a more proactive president. And I think calling him an isolationist is a little bit of a misnomer.
There's one country that we haven't mentioned yet. It's the Ukraine. And I think this is also a place where we've seen Russian politics unfold. And the events there were heavily interlinked with the European Union. As if you remember, they started with the suspension of an association agreement with the European Union. And that later led to the Russian intervention, first in Crimea and then in the Donbas region. Volodymyr, how did you perceive the role, or rather the non-role, in the Ukraine crisis?
Of the European Union, right?
Yeah.
Well, first of all, I would like to thank you for bringing this question. And if I may come back a second to the Brexit, which was mentioned here, and how did it influence those countries that are not inside the European Union, but rather outside, in particular Ukraine. I can tell you that with Brexit, European Union lost a lot, and we should not underestimate the impact that that decision had on the countries outside of the European Union. In particular, in Ukraine, Brexit really influenced the attractiveness of this union, and we should also take this in mind. Now, coming back to Russia, and this is a long story. Even before we turn to Russia specifically, whatever was mentioned, Russia was mentioned as well, among other things. So this is a country that is trying to influence everything, and not only in Europe, but all over the world. For us, we are not talking about Russian politics these days, I mean for Ukrainians, but rather we are talking about Russian aggression against Ukraine and Russian annexation of Crimea. So these two dominating themes are now inside Ukraine. And of course, the question comes up, what has been done by the rest of the world vis-a-vis those two huge challenges, or rather two threats that Ukraine is facing? My short answer is not much, except for sanctions that are being imposed on Russia, although limited, but they play their role, and hopefully just in 2 days' time, the European Union will take yet another decision to continue for another 6 months the sanctions against Russia. We cannot name an important creative mechanism that could bring about peace in Ukraine. Of course, we are talking about Normandy format. We talk about Minsk process. But I'm not here representing my government, rather in my personal capacity. So for me, it's easy to say now that neither Normandy format nor Minsk agreement produced any results. And as far as I am concerned, and as far as many even politicians or experts are concerned, they all started to talk about necessity to revisit the mechanism that could bring about, number one, peace in Ukraine, and number two, bring back or deoccupy part of the territory of a country that is a member of the United Nations and a member of the OSCE, and a country that is willing to become a member of the European Union.
Mariam, I think Volodymyr just said that the EU didn't do much. I think Georgia always had as well very close diplomatic and economic ties to the European Union. And yet, when it came to the conflict with Russia back in 2008, it seems the EU played almost, or as well, a very modest or almost non-existent role. What would you have expected from your European partners back then?
Thank you. Actually, when we speak on Euroscepticism, it sounds a bit strange to hear from such countries as Georgia and Ukraine about their aspirations towards European Union, which is very strong. I'm representing a country which is in a crossroads of Asia and Europe, and some 20 years ago we made firm decision to move towards Europe and to share the values. We did our best, as well as Ukraine, and met all the benchmarks necessary to become the part of the Europe. Just to go back to the war in 2008, Georgian-Russian war, which was, in our opinion, kind of wake-up call for the West to look from a different scope to the very high political trust towards Russia. It was kind of rehearsal when we speak about Crimean case from the Russian side, that we're testing the reaction from the West. And when it was obvious that the reaction was not sufficient, the Crimean case was kind of continuation of the aggression. Even on Crimea, kind of consensus led to the further escalation, and there is still ongoing casualties in Ukraine. Unfortunately, Ukraine is not on headlines anymore. On the other hand, we're on a high track in terms of meeting benchmarks of European integration. I mean, Georgia, as well as Ukraine and Moldova, those so-called willing countries, associated countries, which have signed association agreement instead of very firm obstacles from the Russian side. This was the obstacle directed against pro-Western orientation of those so-called willing countries. Now, we are expecting very soon the decision on visa-free travel for Georgians and Ukrainians to Europe, and we consider it as a tangible outcome of this process, full of sacrifices and reforms. It's very important deliverable, not because of free travel, but because of the showing the standby which comes from our Western partners. I would just like to stress the Maidan case. It was the first time in the history of Europe when people sacrificed their lives under the EU flag. And I think actually Ukraine deserves more attention and more standby from the Europe to preserve the concept of European values, shared European values, and to preserve the European Union as united concept, which is a guarantee of stability in the region, which is very vulnerable. I mean, the neighborhood of the European Union. At the same time, there are, let's say, not positive, but quite important sides of the Ukrainian crisis. Firstly, it's Ukrainian crisis and actually showed up the real face of Russia and Russia's policy. And the second thing is the Russian propaganda, which is something new for the West, but it has very long history and quite good, how to say, institutional memory, how to do it. I mean, Russians are very sophisticated to communicate. And when we speak about Euroscepticism and when we speak about Brexit, when we speak about populism, propaganda is part of it. And I would say that populism is a part of propaganda. If we look at these very popular YouTube videos after the Brexit, when British citizens were surprised by the direct impact they would have after the referendum, they were quite surprised by the new information. We see that it was part of miscommunication and lack of information about the outcomes of the Brexit, and it means that it was a populism, it was a dissemination of false information. It's great that most of the stakeholders are now involved in countering the Russian propaganda, which is a very sophisticated, tailor-made mechanism of spreading false information to the specific groups of population, and it's already a success. We see the success in Ukraine. We see how the false information is disseminated. We see the outcome of the elections in the US. We see far-right tendencies and trends during the political processes in the Europe. Georgia also suffers from the propaganda, though the support of European integration is quite high. We are very pro-European country. It varies from 75% to 80%, I mean the support of both European and Euro-Atlantic integration. But Brexit, as it was already mentioned by my Ukrainian colleague, had very negative impact on opinion, on the attitude towards Europe, and propaganda in Georgia is very specific. It's mostly based on preserving Georgian national identity. What I want to say, in every place, Russians are having their specific, very tailor-made narratives to make it organic to the realities. So just briefly to sum up, I'd like to stress that for us, European Union is a guarantee of stability. It's exit from very tough security situation. It's an opportunity to become more democratic, more developed as a country. And on the other hand, we are expecting the Europe to be stable and to deliver to those countries who are partners, who are eager to become part of the family.
I think you just raised the very important point of the relationship to Russia. Volodymyr, could you quickly build on this?
Yes, but before doing that, I would like to briefly mention one thought that I think is important, at least it is important in Ukraine, and it's a part of the foreign policy debate, and that is the fact that we in Ukraine think that our war with Russia is war not only between Russia and Ukraine, but it's the war that is designed to defend Europe. And this is a popular feeling that Ukraine is standing on the way of Russian expansion towards further down west. So this is not very much recognized in many European capitals, but I think if someone would think thoroughly about this, it would really understand what it is all about. Now, coming back to Russian, as I said, when we are talking about Ukraine-Russia relation, you have to look at them through the perspective of the aggression and the war in the east of Ukraine. Now, we do not have any meaningful relations right now with the Russian Federation because of the fact that Russia has chosen to invade Ukraine and annex its territory. How it would develop, it's very hard to say. But of course, when you know, when the gun talks, diplomats are keeping silence. So we first of all have to, as I said before, design a mechanism how to resolve the issue. And we, I mean, Ukrainians cannot do it without the help of Europe. And we need to be more creative in finding mechanisms. We have not yet exhausted all possible political instruments. And in this respect, I would like to mention Budapest Memorandum, which is simply forgotten now, but I think we need to revisit this issue to those countries that have signed and that gave guarantees to Ukraine back in 1994 in exchange of the nuclear weapon status of Ukraine, should think twice today how to get back to that document and see what can be done to revitalize and to give a new life to this document. Plus, I can say that we have not yet exhausted all the possibilities of the multilateral fora, like in the first place, the United Nations. Although we all understand that Russia has a veto power in the Security Council, but still, there are so many other instruments within the United Nations format that can be used in terms of bringing back Crimea and, I mean, international courts and other institutions that is available within the United Nations system.
Juha, you also bring a particular voice and view about the relationship to Russia from Finland. How do you envisage that relationship?
Yeah, thank you. I'd like to remain in that Finland is a member of Europe. Finland is a member of European Union since 1995. We became members of European Union together with Sweden and Austria. We are member of Eurozone, but we are not members of NATO. So this is a special feature. We have pretty much a similar position with Sweden, with the exception that Sweden is not member of the of Eurozone. So, working very much together in different fields, especially the security policy questions. The Finland has 1,300 kilometers common border with Russia, and we had a bitter war, 1939 winter war, and then continuation war. My father, for example, was in war 5 years, but after the war we had to find a new ways to live as a neighbor of big Soviet Union, and the firm decision was that it's better have friends as a neighbor than enemy. So this created us the new way of foreign policy, where we have stressed ever since dialogue, cooperation, lowering the tension around, which the example is the OSCE process and its Helsinki meeting 1975. And now, if we are looking forward, the next where we think we could help to create to lower the tension between for example, European Union, Russia, USA, is the next year when Finland is holding the presidency of Arctic Council, where we hope that we could be, as a chairman, could bring to together USA, Canada, Russia, and the Nordic countries. So we believe that through dialogue, through cooperation, we could move forward, we think that through dialogue we could also find better possibilities to get the Ukrainian-Russian relations getting better and finding solutions with any other means. So also the European Union, and we are working as a member of European Union and as participating in the decision-making processes, we try to find ways how to increase dialogue between European Union and Russia, because there is, I have a strong belief that there is no prosperous future for Europe without good cooperation with Russia.
Understood. Thank you very much. I think Volodymyr and Juha put a lot of concrete ideas on the table of how the relationship to Russia could be envisaged and seen. Mark, I had a direct question to you. Is Western and European policy in particular robust enough today to deter President Putin from venturing into further military adventurism?
Well, I don't think it's not only not robust enough, I don't think there's much of a strategy. I mean, look, I think that whether it's interesting that a Georgian public official at a high rank and a Ukrainian would talk about the role of Europe and the US wasn't mentioned once, which is how far we've dropped and people looking to us to help them out. So the answer is no. I mean, even if Mr. Trump wants a different relationship with the Russians and a different relationship with the EU and NATO, he's not saying, let's just, you know, get on our backs and put our legs up. And I think that, in fact, his way of dealing with things is to say, look, we do need more dialogue, but your point that it also needs to be met with the sort of baseball bat that isn't being walked around with, because you cannot negotiate with the Russians and have them perceive you as weak, or with the Chinese. The EU is a little different. So, you know, I have a lot of thoughts, as you know, but except for being born in Germany, I'm no longer a European. So I think that the fact is, I don't see the EU as falling at all, but I do think it needs to, you know, with all due respect, pull out some cojones, and maybe the United States needs to be a little more proactive in being prepared to discuss things, but it can't just be every time you interact that it's negative and that you don't have any commonalities. And I think that's a bad thing. But yes, absolutely, I agree with you that there has to be a more robust and a more strong answer, and that's the only way that Putin responds. Look how he's responding to Trump. He's not responding to Trump because he perceives him as weak. He perceives him as strong and unpredictable.
Mark, you said we do not have much of a European strategy and we are perceived as weak. I believe, Paolo, that this brings us to the fact that, you know, what is it that we're missing? What does the EU need to build today a common, a strong, a coherent foreign policy? And why is that not happening?
Needs leadership, first of all, to have a clear idea of what we need and what we have to do and what we have to share. I mentioned in my previous intervention, how can you establish an anti-terrorist efficient policy without intelligent, serious cooperation? That's why it's one more reason to be worried with Brexit. We need absolutely the cooperation with the British services to have efficient anti-terrorist policy in Europe. Just to be back up, let's try to be practical. When you had Soviet Union, you had an ideological dilemma, the Warsaw Pact, a global ambition. I give you an example why how cooperation with Russia would be a better policy than confrontational attitude. Syria. When President Obama said 2 years ago, after a long hesitation, I'm going to war, red line, no red line, red line, no red line, he said, no boots in the ground. This day, Assad won. If you don't have military solution, what do you have? A political solution. What is a political solution? Security Council. Who is in Security Council? Russia. So you need an agreement with Russia to stabilize Syria, if there is a chance. This is an evidence. This is an evidence, but it's not evident to a significant part of the political elite, both in the United States and in Europe. I give you another, example. If the world in 30, 40 years will be globalized with two pillars, one is United States, the other one is China, from who or to who Russia is closer? Between the United States and China. Probably Russia is closer to Europe. Is it right or wrong that on sectarian jihadism, for instance, we have more coincidences than differences with Russia? So, évidemment, on a beaucoup de différences avec les Russes, mais on a aussi des possibles coïncidences. Et donc, la dernière chose que je voudrais dire, c'est que, si vous me permettez, c'est à propos du Brexit, on parle beaucoup stratégiquement en Europe que l'axe Paris-Berlin a échoué. Les relations économiques, les relations internationales sont devenues plus économiques que jamais. Or, l'axe Allemagne, c'est une économie compétitive, globalement compétitive. La France, pour le moment, ne l'est pas. Quel était l'axe possible? C'était l'axe Berlin-Londres. Le Brexit signifie que l'Europe a perdu la seule grande économie qui pouvait aider l'économie européenne avec les Allemands à garder et poursuivre notre compétitivité. Donc l'Allemagne a resté seule. La vraie victime du Brexit, c'est l'Allemagne. Du point de vue économique, c'était les Anglais qui étaient la deuxième économie de service et la deuxième économie, sinon la première en certains domaines, plus compétitive de l'Europe. Comme l'Europe est en perte de vitesse dans la compétitivité globale, si vous n'avez pas les Allemands avec les Anglais, au moins jusqu'au moment où les Français se décident à faire des réformes et à gagner de la compétitivité. Donc, je dirais que c'est très, très... À ce moment-là, l'Allemagne a perdu son partenaire principal du point de vue économique et l'Allemagne a sur ses épaules tous les problèmes du continent, du point de vue, nommément, de la dette souveraine. C'est une curieuse morale de l'histoire. Finalement, nous, les Européens, nous étions élevés dans l'idée que la croissance signifiait l'inclusion. En Espagne, vous avez l'économie européenne, l'une des économies européennes avec plus de croissance, 3%, c'est magnifique. C'est le double de la moyenne européenne, mais vous avez 20% de chômage. Ça veut dire que, au contraire des États-Unis, où il y a de la flexibilité, l'Europe et sa rigidité, vous pouvez avoir croissance et laisser hors l'espoir et la croissance une génération. Ça ne se résoudre pas avec plus de rigidité. Ça se résoudre avec plus de flexibilité, comme l'exemple américain peut le témoigner. Donc, croissance, ça ne signifie pour le moment inclusion, surtout la jeunesse, surtout dans les taux de chômage très élevés, dans une génération. Après l'économie digitale et dans la globalisation, fermer les frontières, c'est un désastre, c'est un chemin vers l'appauvrissement. Et ça va exclure beaucoup de gens de la croissance globale. C'est seulement ça. Ça a beaucoup changé du point de vue de nos certitudes sur l'Europe. On dirait que la paix sociale, que le Prime Minister Papandreou a mentionné, que la cohésion sociale, elle était originaire de la croissance. Elle ne l'est plus en Europe.
Thank you. Unfortunately, we're pressed by time and we still have an enormous amount of ground to cover and questions that will be interesting to tackle. You just mentioned, Paolo, that the European Union is losing speed, that it's economically lagging behind, that it has no leadership. Mariam, coming from Georgia, what is your view on this? And is the EU, from a Georgian perspective, still an attractive partner? Or are you now looking elsewhere when it comes to political, to economic, and to security partnerships?
Of course, relations with the EU is one of the foreign policy priorities for Georgia, but priorities in terms of cooperation are diverse. First of all, with neighboring countries, so including Turkey and the United States is the main partner of the country in terms of political and economic relations. But still, when it comes to the ongoing processes and reforming of the country, European Union is supposed to be a kind of mechanism, a leverage, which is supporting Georgia financially and politically in terms of developing concrete sectors, directions to become real democracy and sustainable. In that sense, the Eastern Partnership project, which was initiated by Sweden and Poland, and is a project which joins six neighboring countries: Moldova, Georgia, Ukraine, Azerbaijan, Armenia, and Belarus. Was a project to develop these countries, to develop and to support them to become real democracies. But unfortunately, from this project, just three countries succeeded. And it was quite unexpected, both for the EU and for Russia as well. And once again, I want to stress that the obstacles coming from the north, from Russia, makes us stronger, because this is a kind of obstacle which consolidates all efforts to come over the difficulties and constraints and to achieve the goal which seems kind of exit, kind of opportunity for the country to develop. Of course, there are different influences and interests. You know, this Eurasian Union, the kind of invisible union initiated by Russia, kind of mechanism to impose their interest towards the region, is of course a topic of discussion in Georgia as well. But when it comes to the polls and when it comes to the opinion researches, we are still on the high track in terms of supporting developing the country towards the West, towards NATO, towards EU, and we have to preserve it. For government, it's really very important to preserve this emotional support from Georgian population toward the West. And we have a lot of challenges in this regard, and that's why we hope that all stakeholders, our partners, United States, EU, will do its best to deliver and to strengthen the support that we have and to treat Georgians as real partners.
Volodymyr, can I ask you, and ask you for a short response on this, but can I direct the same question to you? Is the Ukraine still looking at Europe as its main strategic partner? or does it have to make other choices?
The short answer is yes. We do have the European strategy, I mean European policy as the strategic policy of Ukraine, and we are trying to do our best to really make steps towards Europe, provided Europe is equally interested in Ukraine moving closer to Europe. And as you know, we have a number of different problems on that path. In particular, for instance, if you take the decision of the Dutch parliament, or rather referendum, to stop ratification process of association agreement with Ukraine. So if we end up in ruining this association agreement, which I don't think we will, but nobody knows, then probably there will be a situation when we have to think about options. And but before concluding, if I may just say, echo what my colleague from Finland has said about building relations with Russia, but the key word here is after the war. And we all remember that Soviet Union lost that war with Finland. And of course, Finland at that time was in a position to build relations further on. So what I would like to say that today, and this is very important, I would like to bring this message, that we do not have a civil war in Ukraine, number one. We do not have Russian-Ukraine war per se, but we rather have a war which is between the ability of a country to go along its own path and the attempts of another country to impose its will on this choice. So if we accept this notion and see Ukraine-Russian situation right now as the threat to a wider world, not only for Ukraine, then we need to get together and find out mechanisms how to deal with that. And I did mention United States, as you know, Budapest Memorandum was signed by President Clinton. So certainly when I mentioned Budapest Memorandum, I implicitly meant that without the United States intervention into this situation, I would doubt that we will find a solution acceptable to Ukraine and to Europe.
We haven't really had the time to talk about the issue of refugees yet in the European Union. And one country that we haven't really talked about is Turkey. The deal between the European Union and Turkey has helped curb the refugee flow to Europe. And now Turkey uses this as a foreign policy tool and at each possible turn threatens to scrap the deal controlling the borders to the European Union. George, my question to you, how should the European Union manage its relationship to Turkey?
Well, I was always a proponent, and I changed very much the Greek policy, but also then the European policy in opening up the possibility for membership for Turkey. And I want to get a little bit back to to Russia, because it also pertains to Turkey, because I think we may need to make a differentiation here between this fascination around Putin, and there are people in Europe and leaders in Europe, unluckily, that worries me, that they like this type of leadership, this sort of strong, in quotation marks, type leadership, which I think people are sort of reverting to this more for authoritarianism as ways to solve our problems, which I think will create more problems, more conflicts, more dead ends. But that's very different than saying, what is the strategic interest of Europe in the long run, minus Putin? It is to integrate Russia into a wider system of values, economy, even security. The same goes with the strategic interests of Europe towards Africa, where we are now, really to integrate, to open up, to develop contacts, to develop a migratory policy, not only refugees, but a migratory policy, to invest, to see the energy links, to see the win-win situations. And that applies to Turkey also. Turkey is going through a very difficult phase. I see my good friend here, Yasir Yakis. We were together foreign ministers when he was foreign minister in Turkey, and that was at the beginning stage, the initial stage of Erdogan's reign and his win. And Turkey was doing quite well. And I feel that one of the reasons Turkey was doing well for a number of years was this pull, this attraction towards the European Union. And it modernized, it opened up its society, it got the military out of politics, it looked at human rights in a different way, minorities, the Kurdish issue. It was moving, and of course its economy, it was moving in a very different direction. Now, it has become much more a divided country. As a neighbor, I don't want to get too critical, because we have to keep this good relationship, but there are definitely problems in Turkey today. If we lose, however, this strategic partnership and this prospect of Turkey becoming part of this wider European family, that will make things worse, both for Turkey and for the European Union. I have always been in favor of, for example, visa liberalization. We need to move on that. There are certain preconditions, of course, but we need to move on that. I don't like seeing the refugee issue instrumentalized. I don't like it as a foreign policy tool or as any kind of a tool. I was a refugee in Sweden during the dictatorship in Greece. I know what it means to be a refugee. But I think that this deal we have with Turkey, yes, has slowed down the refugee flow, but it's a stopgap. It's not going to solve the refugee problem. And the refugee problem is not just Syria. There are many parts of the world. Climate change will be one of the major issues for refugee flows very, very soon. It already is, but it will be even more so as years go on. I think we need to, yes, strengthen our borders, but also change our migration policy. Our defense has to develop, but at the same time, see our neighborhood, negotiate, be strong negotiators, strengthen Europe, but in a way that we want to integrate and not keep people out. In whether it's being a member, as Turkey has as a prospect, or whether it is simply a partner, as Russia should be in the future. So I would say this policy with refugees has worked for a period of time, but it could break down. And we see some of the problems already even in Greece now, with there's an increase, slow, but there's an increase. So I would say we need to keep engaging with Turkey, but also be very clear on the criteria on what Europe needs. And this is the strength that Europe does have, and it has not utilized as much. The more we will get into this populism and this closing borders and so on, the less strength we will have then to actually help countries, whether it's Ukraine, whether it's Georgia, whether it is in our relationship with Turkey, in this integrating into a common family of values, which I think is very important for Europe and for the world.
As our discussion is coming to an end, I'd like to finish as well with a positive note. Many say that the arrival of millions of migrants and asylum seekers can also be a great opportunity for an aging Europe, but only if Europe acts swiftly to provide training and jobs to these people. Paolo, are we doing what is necessary for this to be a success?
No, obviously no. The European growth is half of the American one, so we are not doing enough. It's basic. It's 1.5, with 10% or to 11 on unemployment. America has 4.6 on unemployment and 3% of economic growth. I'm not comparing with China, okay? So this is an opportunity, obviously. But you need to fight for that goal. If you don't have, look, can you imagine? We have no children. We are against migrants. Now we are against trade. What do we want? Justin Trudeau was absolutely right when he said, écoutez, il a dit en français, hein, Écoutez, l'Europe est contre un accord de commerce avec le Canada, mais si l'Europe est contre un accord de commerce avec le Canada, avec qui l'Europe veut faire le commerce? Bon. Just one last detail on Turkey. I'm very heterodox also on in Turkey. I'm in favor of Turkish accession to EU. Do you know the first time Turkey asked for that accession? 1963, if I remember well. The more European is Turkey, the less Ottomanized will be its foreign policy. We'll have to choose. We'll have to choose. If we want, if we consider Turkey a very relevant regional player, it is. If we consider relevant, Turkey relevant as border with Asia and in our relation with Islam, we have to choose. The worst thing is not to saying the truth. I guess, namely Germany and France, have a very dissimulated speech or rhetoric in this matter. If you don't say, we are saying to the Turks, we are in favor of the accession. At the same time, one chapter is closed for years and years of negotiation. So we say to the Turks, we are in favor of accession, and in reality, we do exactly the contrary. Do you know what's the problem one of these days? The problem will not be to have Turkey in or out, will be, and it's much more worrying, to have Turkey pro or against. Because we are not telling them the truth. And that allows all the all the radicalization we are also seeing in Turkish politics. So it's just I'm in favor of Turkey in EU. That would be a much greater EU, a much more ambitious EU. That would establish bridges with other continents and other cultures. That would be very good economically. It's a large market of 70 million people, or 74. If Germany and France don't want it, better say it than say the contrary and after in facts cause deception. Okay?
Thank you very much. I think this brings our discussion to an end. Thank you very much, dear panelists, for taking part in it. Thanks to you for following the discussion. Stay with us. The program continues after this session with the session of the return of Morocco in the African Union. Have a great day and thank you very much.